five, six points. We took them, they won't fly.
Amen. Good morning, folks. Amen. Beautiful day the Lord's blessed us with. Amen. Amen. It might rain a little while, but right now we can see the sun. Right? Amen. One quick announcement. Lance said that somebody with a red Cavalier had their radio still on. So I don't know if that'll run your battery down or what, but that's what Lance said.
It is.
It is? Okay. So if you want to take care of that. Also, Juanita said women's meeting at what time? 6:30 on Tuesday. So if you can come out, I'm sure you'll be blessed for coming. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, there's one showing up. All right, we got several people on the prayer list this morning. Mark and Jennifer Cook, needs our prayers when we pray. She has cancer. Gary Blankenship family needs our prayers. Jordan Mitchell, Donna Mauger, Angela Toller, Misty Ellis, the Cook family, Linda Counts, Jeanette Hall, Gary Cook, Dean Hash, says headed to the hospital for some testing. Pray for Josh and Tammy. Josh is back in the hospital and thankful, having some heart issues. Leanne Lane, Tara's sister, pregnant, blood pressure's way up, needs our prayers. Got an unspoken request on here, and Randy Prince needs our prayers as we pray. Anybody else? All right, well, let's go to the Lord. Go ahead, Sherry.
Susie Thompson.
Susie Thompson. Do you remember Susie? Had her kidney removed. She's debating whether she's going to have chemo or not. So, big decision. They said that she may need to have it, so it's a big decision. So, let's pray for her as we pray this morning. And we'll go before the Lord in prayer this morning, all right?
Come on, folks. I encourage you to come this morning. Come on. Come on, let's gather in here and just have a good season of prayer. Come on. Scripture says, cast all your care upon Him, for He careth for you. Father in heaven, we want to thank you today for your love, your mercy, and for your goodness today, Father. Thankful and grateful for another beautiful day that you've blessed us with. What a beautiful sunshiny day it is out there, just the warmth of this beautiful sunshine. And Lord, we go beyond that, and we just feel the warmth of your presence, the warmth of your spirit today. We're just so thankful and grateful today for your presence. Thankful for the Holy Spirit today. We're thankful that you told your disciples that you would not leave them comfortless, but it was expedient, it was to their advantage that you go away. For you said if you didn't go away, you couldn't send the Comforter. But I'm thankful that you sent us a helper. I'm thankful you sent one just like you. Oh, I'm so thankful and grateful today for the presence of the Holy Spirit. We want to thank you today for the privilege we have to get in this house. David said, I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'm thankful today that my feet have been led to the sanctuary of God. And I'm so thankful for the privilege I have here today to worship the God that I serve today. And I am so thankful that we have the liberty here to do that. I'm so thankful today that we can come together under one roof with people like Precious Faith, that we can make one sound unto heaven, a sound of praise, a sound of worship to our God today. God, that we know that reigns forever. God, that I know that I know that is alive and well. And God, that I know that is in control of our lives. I'm so thankful and grateful for that. Thankful that we serve a God that is so well acquainted with us that the very hairs of our head are numbered. Thankful today to know that you know us that well. You know every need of our life here today, Father. You know everything we're going through, everything we're facing today. Every decision that we need to make, every trial, every burden, every circumstance, every dark season, every need in this building, Father, you know. Every individual, you know. And today, I'm so thankful that we can gather today in this house to know that we serve a God that hasn't forgotten us. We serve a God that I know that cares. When you tell us in your word to cast all of our care upon you, for you care for us. And today, I pray that every need on that prayer list today, every name that went up, I plead the blood over today and pray that your will is going to be done. I pray for healing to come to their bodies. For we know today that it is your will that we be whole. It is your will that we be healed. Because your scripture plenty tells us that the stripes you received on your body, you received from the healing of our body. You carried our infirmities and bore our diseases on Calvary. And so I'm thankful today that we don't have to carry it, we don't have to bear it. Because you've already done that. We give you praise today for that we do. Today we want to acknowledge our need in this meeting today. We want to acknowledge our need of you, Holy Spirit. Without you, nothing can be accomplished in this house here today. But if you will come, and you will invade this house with your presence, I know great things can be accomplished for the kingdom of God. I know that if you'll come, I know that if you will come, and I know that if we'll create the atmosphere, you will come. Because I know that you inhabit the praises of your people. I know that the Father seeketh those that will worship him in spirit and in truth. And today I pray that every believer today will use this time, this awesome privilege we have to worship you. That we will stand on our feet. We will raise our hands in praise and adoration to our God. Unashamedly, unreservedly, we will sing from our heart. We will lift our voice from our heart today. We will deliberately choose to have good worship Him today, that we can exalt our God here today, because you've been too good to us, and you've been too good for us, for us to come together as a body of believers to remain silent. We will exalt you in the assembly of the upright. We will exalt your name. Oh, come, let us magnify the name of the Lord together. The psalmist said, I pray today that your people will come together in this house. We will come together to magnify the name that is above every name. And at that name, every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So come, Holy Spirit, do in this house what only you can do. When all this is said and done, my prayer is to know that we've been in the presence of the Most High God. My prayer is today that we, every one of us in this room, will leave today better than when we came. I pray today that every individual in this house will leave here today knowing that we've been in the presence of the Most High God. We need you to come, Holy Ghost, to change the atmosphere we're in. We need you to come and change our lives. We need you to come and change our direction. We need you to come and breathe upon us your divine presence and your divine glory. We need you to come today in this house and to accomplish the will of God through us here today. As we stand before you, let us accomplish His will in this house here today. And we'll give you praise and we'll give you glory for everything that's accomplished in this room here today. For we ask it in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Ushers, if you would, get ready to see the Lord's tithes and our offering unto Him this morning.
God, as you teach your own son, God, you're more worthy, God, and you're greater, Lord God. Lord, let us say that as
Of the Lord. We'll get back into worship here in just a moment. I just want to acknowledge a few of our seniors here today, and we don't want to bypass them. Great occasion in life, and some of them getting ready to enter into the real world. Hallelujah. Yeah, some of them got to go to work now. That's the bad thing about roll up. Some long way, somebody keeps you out of the house, you got to go to work. Amen. We do have one graduating senior here today, and that is pretty little Carla Cook. Come on up here, girl. Come on. Just want to give you that. Tell us your plans. Tell us what you going to be in. What are you going to school with? What you going to do?
I'm going to Potomac State. I'm playing basketball. To major in business management and go to law school.
Your head swelled a little bit there, but I kind of cool you down. You're young, man. We also got some graduating. Some college students here today that has graduated college, and that is, those are the ones I'm talking about. It's time to be into the real world. Okay, we got some of them here today, so that is just an honor and self-pleasure to have them here today. We got Christian Hanninger. Come on up here, bro. Come on up here. You young ladies, he's single, by the way. Now be young, old grab this one. And you got to find his mommy, too. God bless you. Tell us what you're going to do, man. I know you're going to work. Hallelujah. Trying to find a job. Okay. Wait a minute. What did you graduate from? Glenville State. Yeah. What's your major been?
Criminal justice.
Oh, God. Don't look at them on the front row. They look pictures at the boat dock. Yeah. You recognize them off of that, didn't you? Oh, man. You're a good looking young man. Where's Kylie? Come up here, Kylie. Man, come on up here, buddy. I know this girl from way back. I know her when she was just a little bitty thing. Born, buddy. I know her when she was born. I know she came out of the womb, didn't she? Yeah. And she done graduated high school and graduated college. And you're still going to college, or you're still going to for the master's?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Where at? Tell her.
Concord.
And... what's your major?
Social work.
God help a father, help a Jesus. God look. Good luck, buddy. God bless you. Katie, come on, girl. Come on, girl. I like this one right here because she's starting a family, buddy, and graduated. Praise God. Graduated from Bluefield State. Majored in. I know what you're going to be doing. You'll be having a baby. And teaching on top of that. You've got a full-time job, though. If you need a babysitter, your grandmother's, you know, she's, your grandma, your mommy, excuse me, God forgive me, your mommy's a baby. It's the occasion. You call grandma that? Well, that's what the baby's going to call grandma. See, I didn't mess up, did I? I'm good. That's what you say right now in front of everybody until you go out the door. I ain't saying that. You sit down. Now you get me in trouble. God bless you. Thank you. Levi Lambert's right here. Yeah, Levi's right here. But Levi's graduating from Bluefield State, right, Garrett? Okay, that's the son of Garrett Mortigale Lambert. And Levi had an uphill battle with his mommy Mortigale, but he made it. Praise God. He made it. Garrett's been trying for many years to get under subjection. He's still trying. So, but we appreciate all of her. Give all these kids a good time. Remember when you went to college, man? Remember when you went to college? You was a heathen, wasn't you? But you went to college.
I'd love to go back.
You kidding me? Was you seriously?
Oh, yeah.
No way.
You are crazy. Hey, buddy. You're saved now. You can't go back. Praise God. Congratulations, all you seniors. Congratulations. All you that's graduated college.
Yeah.
We might, hey, we might be raising our Social Security, but we can do the good work. God bless you. God bless you. You be blessed. You hear me? Okay. All right. Okay, y'all ready to worship a little while?
Yeah.
All right, give the Lord a good day. God bless you. Come on. Get on your feet and step.
God on the earth. Sing about the glory of his name. Tell the world how glorious he is. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Your enemies cringe before your mighty power. Everything on earth will worship you. They will sing your praises, shouting your name in glorious songs. Come and see what our God has done. What awesome miracles he performs for people. He made a dry path through the Red Sea and his people went across on foot. There we rejoice in him, for by his great power, he rules forever. He watches every movement of the nations. Hallelujah. Verse 8 says, let the whole world bless our God and loudly sing his praises. Our lives are in his hands, and he keeps our feet from stumbling. Hallelujah. Verse 4, let's go back. It says, everything on earth will worship you. They will sing your praises, shouting your name in glorious songs. Hallelujah. Come on and let's sing his praises this morning and shout his name. Let's bless the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Jesus.
We love to shout your name.
upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. Hallelujah. He is the God that restores. Hallelujah. It has been proclaimed in this house by the Spirit of God that this is the year of restoration. Hallelujah. And in Revelation 21, when John had his glimpse of heaven, he saw him who sat on the throne, and he said, "Behold, I make all things new." He is the God of restoration this morning. He raises dead things to life. Hallelujah. He turns your mourning into dancing. He can give you joy in the midst of your sorrow. Restoration. Hallelujah. Raise your hands and worship him all over the house. We bless your name, Jesus. You bring restoration. You bring restoration. You bring you take it my pain. Pentecost Sunday. Hallelujah. This is the day that we celebrate Pentecost Sunday, 50 days after Jesus' resurrection. Hallelujah. And the pastor has been preaching about how the latter glory will be greater than the former, and they experienced that greater glory in the upper room that day when the Holy Spirit fell upon them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God, that promise is for us this morning. That promise is still for us this morning, that that Spirit would fall upon us. And so I cry out myself, Lord, fall afresh on me today, God. Fall afresh on me, God. Fill me today again with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill us today in this place, God. Thank you, Lord, that you sent your Holy Spirit to dwell in us. Hallelujah. Not only are you the God with us, but you are the God in us. And we bless your name this morning, Jesus. We cry out to you and we thank you, Lord, for you are a good God. You are a mighty God. You're a holy God. You're a saving God. You're a delivering God. You're a healing God. You're a worthy God. You're the one true God. And we bless your name, Jesus. We bless you this morning, God. Hallelujah. We bless you this morning, Father God. If we don't praise you, the rocks will cry out. So, Father God, let no rock cry out in my place, Lord. But I lift up the name of Jesus this morning. I lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I bless your name, Jesus. I bless your name, Jesus. That name, the only name under heaven whereby man may be saved. I bless your name, Jesus. And I lift you up. I glorify you. I glorify you. I glorify you. I glorify you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, let it worship. Let it praise. Begin to arise up out of your belly in this place. Don't just wait for another song to start. Hallelujah. Don't just wait for the message to come. Come on, begin to worship him and praise him. Begin to lift your hands and lay on him. Hallelujah. Not in response to the song up here, but in response to God's goodness in your life. We bless your name, Jesus. We once were dead, but now we are alive. We once were blind, but now we see. I was once bound for hell, but now you have given me eternal life. And I praise you for that, God. I praise you for that this morning, Lord. I praise you for it. And I
I believe the best is yet to come. Come on, Kelly. While Kelly's getting ready, I want to welcome Amanda and Ben Models with us today. She's here next to me. She told me she went to school with my son, and I immediately told her he acts just like his mom. So, I hope that went over good. I could tell by looking at her she didn't believe that, and I can tell looking at her now she still don't believe that. Amen. You ready, Kelly? Now you sing like I taught you.
I don't have a CD or anything. I'm just singing this to the Lord, and this was a request, and I just love it myself. So these old hymns sometimes just bring back the foundation, you know, that the Lord just gave us a long time ago. So just pray for them, and most of all that He'll be glorified.
Amen. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll,
somebody give me a testimony that it is well with my soul. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All hell may be breaking loose in my life, but I tell you, it is well with my soul. Hallelujah. Everything in my life may be falling apart, but thank God it is well with my soul. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It is well. It is well with my soul. Amen. I said I need Matt, one more acknowledgement, and we're going to get in with the meeting and service today. It's so good to have Mr. and Mrs. Matthew Campbell with us today. Those of you that don't know, He finally found somebody to marry. Thank God, God raised him born out of love him. You know, I'm oblivious. There's always somebody for everybody. God has somebody for everybody. I feel sorry for you, Ashley, but you'll be all right, baby. You'll be all right. You'll be all right. He'll get better as he gets older. He will. Just hang on to him. He's about 90. He'll be all right. He'll be all right. Thank God. Amen. We had the honor of marrying that couple yesterday, and we thank God for that today. And they're in the house of God this morning. Crazy. I ain't going there. Let's go to the children's church before I get in trouble. Let's go. Let's go. Michael, you're in charge, man. Michael, go for it, man. Amen. Let's go to the children's church. Let's go. All right. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. All right. Amen. God is good. God is good. Amen. I got one amen out yet. I got two out there. Amen. Praise God. All right. Okay. All right. You have your Bibles. Go with me to 1 Corinthians this morning, chapter 10. At least where our scripture's at. I'm going to start. Now, if you want to go through Mark chapter 9, you want to grab chapter 9, you can. And we'll go through here. And I've got a lot to cover today. And before I get started this morning, I do want to say that message today will be R-rated. I don't expect no amens. I don't get come for a bunch. Because a word like this, you don't get a whole lot of amen though. But it's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. So we can't change the Word. And I would rather hear the word about the world while I'm here in this world and know what to avoid and what to cleave to. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay. All right. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 is where I'll start in just a few moments. And I will be in Mark chapter 9 after a while. It's going to take me a while to get there. But you just bear with me and I'll try to hurry. I'll try not to bore you. And I will try not to be too long today, but I do have just a little bit of what I need to share with you today. Today I want to continue to talk about the hindrances to being one body. The hindrances to being one body. And Heather sang some of the song that I truly believe that, well, Jesus prayed it in John chapter 17 in his high priestly prayer that we would be made one like he and his Father are one. And he's trying to get his body into oneness. Trying to get his body into oneness. And I believe that is the key to the latter glory being greater than the former glory is when we come together as one body of believers to exalt his name and to magnify his name. But today we want to continue talking about the hindrances to being one body. Several weeks ago we talked about this thing called idolatry. The hindrance of idolatry. And this morning I want to take that just a little bit deeper and a little bit farther this morning than what we were week before last. We took a break from Mother's Day last week, so today I want to go back to this and go from there. So we'll just see where it goes, all right? 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 14. The Apostle Paul records these words writing to the church. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, now I can stop right there, and I can say when he says, well, that's the New Living Translation, but the King James says, wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee idolatry. Flee idolatry. Paul is writing to the church. He's writing to Christians, to the people of God. And he's telling the church to flee from idolatry. So idolatry must be pretty serious if the man of God that wrote most of his New Testament wrote to the church to flee from it. It must be pretty serious to God for his church to know that we are to flee from idolatry. Now, let's get an understanding about idolatry, all right? Idolatry is more than just bowing down to some statue or to some carved out wooden god or to bow down to some altar of some shine. Idolatry is humanity putting aside what God clearly wants
in order to satisfy his or her own desires, which, by the way, are contrary to God's desires. But for a Christian, on the screen, a Christian engages in idolatry when he or she disregards what God has clearly revealed in order for them to obtain a strong desire. You put aside what God has said in his word. We covered some examples a couple of weeks ago. We talked about Achan, how Achan coveted, how he had a strong desire for that Babylonian garment and that wedge of gold that he saw there in Jericho, when the specific order of God was that everything in Jericho was to be dedicated to God. Achan saw this, coveted that with a strong desire, and took that, hid that in his tent, and the end result was Achan lost his life, his family lost their life, even 36 men died in Israel because of that sin of idolatry. David is another good example who had a strong desire for another woman by the name of Bathsheba and committed adultery. When a Christian engages in idolatry, it is when he or she disregards what God has clearly revealed in order to obtain and to have that strong desire that they have. Idolatry on the screen is knowing disobedience to the will of God. In other words, I know it to be against the will of God, but yet I do it anyway. Now, it's not the same as a believer falling into sin. There's a difference when a believer falls into sin and repents. Idolatry occurs when a believer is given over to sin. And that man or that woman now has elevated that desire above God's will and above God's desire. You can say amen every now and then, and they won't scare you. Because that's truth right there. When we begin to elevate our carnal desires above the will and the desire of God, knowing clearly what the Word says, we enter into idolatry when we begin to fulfill those desires that we have elevated above God's desires. Okay, preach on. Okay. On the screen, next statement. Idolatry is not merely sin. It's intentional or known sin. There's a big difference there. And what that person judges to be important, they will possess or they will do, no matter what God has said in his word. God, this is tough. I know it's tough. You shouldn't have come today. What that person does, when that takes place, is what that person considers important, judges to be important. They will possess it at all costs, or they will do it, no matter what God says in his word. I've been around long enough to know this. Now, I've been around long enough to know this. And if somebody's headset in doing something, come hell or high water, they will do it. I talk about Christian people. I'm not talking about the world. I'm in the house of God. I know, listen to me. I've been around long enough. Preaching like this won't build a church. It'll thin it out. It won't build it. Paul said in the last days that they won't endure sound doctrine now. They won't do it. They'll heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, motivational preachers that will, speakers that will motivate you instead of getting you ready for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to talk about some hard stuff today. So y'all stay with me here, okay? Somebody say, preacher. I love you right now. But I don't know about later. I made you say that because you probably ain't going to love me here in about an hour and a half later and I won't shut up. Can I go on?
Yeah.
Can I go on? Watch now. Watch. Idolatry is not mere sin. It's intentional known sin. And it's when that person judges what they consider to be important and they go that extra step to possess it or do it, no matter what. No matter what God has said in his word. Look at me. Is that not what took place in the garden? When Adam and Eve started this thing out? what they perceived was good, and what they perceived was profitable, and what they perceived that was pleasant with the eyes and would make them wise. God gave them specific instructions. Eat out of every tree in the garden, but there's one tree right here. Do not eat this tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The day you eat of that tree, you're going to die. You will surely die. I promise you, you're going to die if you eat from that tree. What did they do? They deliberately disobeyed what God had clearly spoken. And the rest is history. But here's the danger. Here's the danger. Once we have chosen this course of action, here's the danger. Deception now sets in. And now we fully believe that we are still in good standing with God, when in reality, we're not. James 1:22. Look at James. James says, "Be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only." What's the good of the word? Deceiving yourselves. Right. When we clearly hear the word of God and we do not obey what we clearly hear, something happens to us. A veil of deception covers our hearts. And now if we continue in that deception, now we fully believe that we have the right view of God, we have the right view of Christ, we have the right view of the kingdom of God, when we really do not have the right view.
Right.
Whoa. The word deceive, look on the screen. The word deceive means to cause someone to believe something that is not true. Typically to in order to gain some personal advantage in the ordeal. Deceive means to cause to accept as true what is false. Deception. Intentional disobedience is not something to take lightly. And most church folk take it lightly because they do not understand the true concept of grace. Oh yeah. They believe all is covered by grace and forgiveness and love, and they believe grace is a cover-up instead of a covering. Grace is an empowerment to overcome the sin in your life. It is not a cover-up, it is a covering. And they believe that grace now. But look on the screen. But the same God who reveals His grace and forgiveness and love is also the very same one who reveals the danger and the consequences of practiced disobedience or intentional sin. It's the same God that will show you the other side of the picture that is not very pretty. Do not take intentional sin lightly. That is a deception and a lie of the enemy. Listen to what Paul speaks out to the Corinthian believers in 1 Corinthians 15:34, Message Bible. It says, "Think straight, awake to the holiness of life. No man playing fast and loose with the resurrection fact. No more playing fast and loose with the resurrection fact. Ignorance of God is a luxury you cannot afford in times like this." I'll hear an amen right there.
Amen.
Aren't you embarrassed that you let this kind of thing, go on as long as you have? Good God, man. Paul is telling the church at Corinth, the church, you have the ability to live like Jesus, but you are still involved in your idolatry. They still believe holding on to what's important to them and ignoring the revealed truth of the Word of God. They played loose the Word of God. They ignored the truth of God's Word in their own life. And as a result, they had no power. They were powerless to change their circumstances. They were powerless to change their family life. They were powerless to change their community. They were powerless to change even the very church. They were powerless. Listen to me. Listen to me. You'll be all right. Listen to me. Our goal has not changed. The goal was with the first church. The goal is still the same today. And our goal, we are to be a revealer of God's glory and God's greatness in our life. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And Paul cried out to the Christian in the Corinthian church, 1 Corinthians 15:34, New King James Version, he said, awake to righteousness and do not sin. Boy, he's telling the church that. Do not sin. Well, hush my mouth. For some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to you, shame. In other words, Paul's saying, listen, he's saying to us, look at me, here's what he's saying. He's saying to us, you are the only Jesus the lost in Corinth will see. And if they don't see evidence of his resurrection power, and they don't see evidence of his nature in you, then they're not going to see it. You know what he's saying to us? He said, look at me. He said that you may be the only Jesus the lost people see on your job. Ooh. Let me say that again. You may be the only Jesus the lost people see on your job. What kind of a Jesus are you revealing to them? Wow. One that gossips about everybody? Scripture says love will cover a multitude of sins, not expose. What kind of Jesus are we revealing to the people around us? That's what Paul was saying to the church at Corinth. Your family, your spouses and children, you could be the only Jesus they see. Amen. My family could be the only Jesus they see. What am I revealing to my family? What am I revealing to the people that's around me? What? Are they seeing the evidence of his resurrection power? Are they seeing his nature in me, in you? When we have the ability to live like Jesus, the scripture says, as he, Jesus, is, so are we in this world. So we can't play loose with the word of God. Can you get an amen? And we cannot ignore the truth of God's word in our life. Amen. They have to see the evidence of his resurrection power, and they have to see his nature living as a display in our lives. Can I get an amen from the church? The early church, this blew my mind. The early church, they were constantly, look at me, they were constantly identified as gods. Amen. And they were forced to cry out, no, we are not gods. We are children of the Most High God. Acts chapter 10, verse 26, Peter had to strongly say to a military officer, he said, stand up. I myself am also a man. In Acts 14 and 14, Paul had to cry out to those citizens in Lystra. He said, what do you think you're doing? We are not gods. In Acts chapter 17, verse 6, the Bible says that those who have turned the world upside down have come here too, and they're going to turn out of the world upside down. In Acts 5 and 13, it says that the citizens of Jerusalem, all the people, had high regard for them. In other words, the early church revealed the evidence of the resurrected Son of God's power. They revealed his nature on the inside of him. They had evidence of his resurrection power. They had evidence of his nature on the inside of him. They were revealers. They were revealing God's glory and God's greatness in their life. And they were constantly identified as gods. And several times throughout the scriptures, they had to forcibly cry out, we are not gods. We are simply children of the Most High God. Amen. Now that is what the latter glory will look like. Oh, I got it. Amen. That is what the latter glory will look like. The latter glory will be people that will show evidence of his resurrection power. They will show evidence of the nature of God living on the inside of them. That's what the latter glory is going to look like. That's what the latter glory is going to look like. Because the latter glory is going to reveal a bunch of little Jesuses running around this earth and running around this community and running around this church and going into the homes and the byways and the hedges. It's what the latter glory is going to be greater than the former glory. And if that took place in the book of Acts, wow. I wonder what's going to take place in the Am I confused? Am I causing any confusion? No.
Okay. I thought I was at Caffey's. I thought I was in more for a while. I did show up at the wrong place, so I'm going to go. All I is, I wonder what made them be confused with gods. Let me tell you what made them, we do look unconfused, because they had evidence of resurrection power operating through them. They had a nature about them that was out of this world, glory to God. They had something about them that flowed out of them and through them and into the multitudes and into the cities and the byways. That something took place when they entered a building. Something took place when they entered a setting, because something was taking place out of natural. It was out of another world, glory to God. It was resurrection power. It was evidence. There was a living God. There's evidence that Jesus rose from the dead and he's seated at the right hand of God the Father. And he sent the Holy Ghost and all power to live in their lives. Yes, sir. Amen. Yes, sir. That's what the light of glory is going to look like. What? Now what? Now this is where it need to be. That was just my introduction. Now this is where it need to be. But for us to move into the light of glory that's going to be greater, or the form of glory is going to be greater than the light of glory. Listen. Here we go. Here we go. We got to overcome this three little word. And I really hate to do that this morning. I hate this little three little word. We've got to overcome this little three little word called oh, Jesus. Oh, God. I mentioned it in the house of God. Anybody notice the middle letter? In sin? I represent self. Behind all sin is selfishness. It's what I want. It's what I desire. But here's what I get you. Here's what sin gets you. Isaiah 59, verse number 2. Here's what it gets you. Isaiah said that your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear you. The New Living Translation says this: it's your sins that have cut you off from God. Wow. Wow. Scary, man, to be cut off from God. From your only source of hope. From your only source of life. And you have cut your lifeline off. Because of your stubborn will, because you wanted to remain in sin, and God wouldn't hear you, because now those iniquities, those sins have separated you from God, and he turns a deaf ear. He will not hear. That's serious, man. Look at this, folks. Listen to me. It's intentional sin that separates us from God. Sin separates us from the divine virtues, and those divine virtues is what we need in order to live a sanctified, holy life. Wow. And when we engage in sin without sorrow, you know what we've done? We've entered into idolatry, and we become adulteresses. And we have put ourselves in enmity against God. That's hard stuff right there, man. That's hard stuff. That's hard stuff. That's X-rated stuff right there, man. But that's the truth of God's word. That's the truth of God's word. You don't hear stuff like that today. They don't want to tell you that today. Sin. Look on the board. Definition. Let's define sin. Sin needs, it means to miss or wander from the path of uprightness and honor. To do or to go wrong. Listen to me. It's a wonder from the law of God. It is to violate God's law. Now listen to me. Listen, when we sin, we get off course. That in our right mind, just like the prodigal, he went to the far country. When he came to himself, he wasn't in his right mind. And when we sin, we get off course that in our right mind, we would never want to veer from that. And if we, listen, if we stay on that course, listen to me, please hear me. If we stay on that course, we deviate from the source of all life, and that is the very life of Christ. Look at me, church. I'm talking to the church. I'm not talking to the world. Paul is writing to the church. Wow, man. Preacher, I'm going to ask you to resign after today. Good. I pray you do that. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We've been taught down through the years that we define sin as missing the mark. Let me ask you something. Does missing the mark adequately describe the serious nature of sin? Really? I don't think it even touches it. Because sin is a very serious matter, man, when it comes to God.
Amen.
You know why? Because sin attacks our strength. It attacks our soundness of mind, our passion and our purpose. It attacks our peace. Sin is harmful. Sin is detrimental. Sin is destructive. And listen. And it may be pleasurable for a season. But that season will run out. And then what? You're left with broken hearts, broken lives. Look at me. Talk to the junior in high school that's pregnant.
That's right.
Talk to an unfaithful spouse. Or to a spouse with his partner's been unfaithful. Don't tell me sin is not destructive. Don't tell me we can just dumb down sin. That's our problem. We dumb down sin long enough. We come to the house of God and we never hear preachers talk about sin no more. Because sin is not very popular, because we want to fulfill this old flesh and indulge in all that we can indulge in. Wow, preacher. You been eating gunpowder all week? No, just about, but not quite. Sin will separate us from God.
Amen.
Amen. I don't care how many times you go to church.
Amen.
You can play the grace part all you want to. And the devil, he'll laugh at you all the way to hell, man. My God, preacher, I went down to day home today. It'd been a good day if you took a pee day today. That's a personal day, not a pee pee day. Preach on, preacher. I believe I will. I ain't done. I'm a long shot being done right now. I just might as well go ahead and make everybody mad while I'm at it. I've been up all week trying to figure out how I'm going to make you mad anyway. Look on the screen this next day. Let's go tonight. Let's go. See, engaging in sin is what it is. It's exchanging a short-term positive for a long-term negative, man. You know why? Because sin has an immediate effect and a long-term effect. Check out David's life and you'll see that right there holds true. Because after sin is over, it stings, man. It bites with long-term consequences of death. And flesh is what gravitates to sin. Oh, but thank God, as a new creature in Christ Jesus and possessing God's nature on the inside of us, we can internally have no desire for it and can turn away from the draw of it. Thank God Almighty. The Bible says you can draw nigh to God and He'll draw nigh to you, and you can resist the devil. You can resist sin and it will flee from you if you'll draw nigh to God. Because you've got a nature on the inside of you that is from God Almighty, and you can resist the draw of sin.
Amen. Amen.
If you want to.
Amen.
I said if you want to.
Amen.
I said if you want to. Okay, let's go on. I'm going to go a little bit deeper. Can I? Say yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm almost done. Come here, on the screen. Sin has a door. Somebody say sin has a door.
Yeah.
Can you prove that, preacher? Yeah, I can prove that. Go to the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 4, verse number 7. Look what? The Lord talking to Cain. Genesis 4 and 7. The Lord said, talking to Cain, you will be accepted if
Somebody say if.
If.
That's a qualifier. If you will do what is right. Oh my, that'll talk. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Why? Because sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master. Picture this. You've got to get that, because where good is, evil's always present. Watch this. What? Look at me. He said, look at me. You'll be all right if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, watch out now, because sin is crouching at the door, wanting to control you. Ooh. Wanting to control you. But you must subdue it, and you must master it. Because if you don't control it, it will control you. If you don't subdue it, it will subdue you. If you don't be its master, it will be your master. Y'all preach on, preacher. What's the progression? What's the progression of sin? Come on. What's the progression? Sin has a door. Why? What's the door called? It's called desire. James chapter 1, verse 14 and 15. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Verse 15, then, when desire has conceived, it gives forth to sin, it gives birth to sin, and when sin is full grown, when it's matured, it brings forth death. Somebody's going to die. Sin has a door. It's called desire. These desires give birth to sinful actions. We put these desires into action. Now the door is either shut or either open. And we choose to open the door or to shut the door according to the decisions that we make upon these desires that we have. Are you listening to what I'm saying? What's the progression? Sin is very eager to control us. Sin has a door, and the door is desire. And sin's desire on the screen is to make us a slave. That's its desire. To make you and I a slave. I said a slave.
Amen.
Jesus warned us in John 8:34. Most assuredly I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin.
Amen.
And Paul goes on to tell the believers now, to the church. Romans chapter 6, verse 16, New Living Translation, Paul told the church, he said, don't you realize that you become the slave of whatever you choose to obey? You can be a slave to sin, which leads to death, or you can choose to obey God, which leads to righteous living or eternal life. That's a no-brainer, man. I choose righteous living. I choose eternal life. I don't want to choose death, do you?
No.
Okay. Peter also said, 2 Peter 2:19, he says, for you are a slave to whatever controls you. Slavery is not a very pretty thing. Very ugly thing. Sin is a ruthless taskmaster. In the end, look at me, it brings forth death. Look at me, something will die in your life. Take it to the bank. Look on the screen. Sin has a desire. Its desire is to enslave us. But here's the scary part. Sin is not obvious in its intention to enslave us. In other words, when sin comes, it doesn't come with a sign that says, I'm sin and I'm coming to enslave you. No. Look at me. Sin is very seductive. Comes in all shapes, sizes, colors. Could be 6 feet, 2 ounces of blood. Could be 4 foot, two. But when sin comes, it's not obvious of its intentions. It's not obvious of its intentions. It's very enticing. Very enticing. Very seductive. Whoa. I got their attention now when I said seductive. They broke up. Whoa.
She's not going to come with a big old banner. And here I am. I've come to enslave you. Hi, Eva, babe. You like me, don't you? Look. Sin has one desire now. To make you a slave.
Amen.
We're talking to the church. I ain't talking to the world, man. The world's a slave. They don't know they're a slave. But there's one thing we're going to know here in this house. We're going to know about sin. We're going to know about being a slave to sin. And if you don't want to come back next Sunday, I don't really care. Because I'll be here. And I'll pay my wife to come with me. And enough of you say you ain't coming back, I'll pay five more of him. I'll pay five more of you come back. I'll just keep it. You'll be back. You know why you'll be back? Because you will know the truth, that's why. Could care less who likes and who don't like, as long as you know the truth. And the truth will set you free. You can play games all you can play church all you want to, man. You can play church the rest of your life until you die and you end up a loser. Oh, I gotta get out of this thing. I'm getting way too deep. Are you still with me?
Amen.
Somebody say preacher.
Preacher.
I ain't gonna tell you what to say. You just say preacher. How many of you know when sin confronts you, it always looks enticing?
Amen.
Never reveals its intensity. It doesn't. It's deceitful. And according to Hebrews 3:13, it hardens our heart. You know what that does? Once our heart starts to get hard, now it's hard for us to feel or hear the leading of the Holy Spirit. We sit numb sometimes. Come on, folks. I'm getting ready to plow some ground in now. Is anybody paying attention to sin's progression? Sin has a door, and it's crouching down at the door, eager to control you. And you must control it, or it will control you. If you don't subdue it, I promise you, it will subdue you. If you don't master it, it will master you. I promise you, that's the route it'll go. The door is called desire. And sin's desire is to enslave you and control you and harden your heart. When you do that, it makes you, it's hard to hear and feel the Holy Spirit. Sin leads us into idolatry. Listen to me. Look at me. Hey, look at me. God appeared to Solomon twice. Two different times, God himself appeared before Solomon. And Solomon ended up worshiping false gods toward the latter end of his life. Amen. The last thing recorded about Solomon was he did evil in the sight of the Lord.
Good God Almighty.
How in the world could someone who God had appeared to two different times turn to false gods? Anybody that was, Solomon was the most wisest man there was. How could anybody get turned like that? Two times God appeared to the man. Solomon didn't finish with him. How could that happen? Look at me. I'll tell you how it happened. Look at me. Deceit. Deception. If it could happen to Solomon, who saw God, how easily could it happen to people like you and I who haven't saw God? Oh, I don't want to go there, but that's all right. Sin is not something to mess with. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
It's very powerful. It can change your heart very, very quickly. But here's the scary part. Come here. Come on. Come to me, Mama. Come on. Come to me, Daddy. Here's the scary part. Watch. In that hardened state, our hearts are now deceived. And now we believe that we are right when we aren't right. Please listen. Please hear me. Please do not believe the lie. I'm covered by grace. And if I sin, I'll be fine down at the end of the road. You know what Paul said? You know what this Bible said? Paul said, don't frustrate the grace of God. Don't take advantage of the grace of God.
Amen.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't believe the lie. Very dangerous. Very dangerous doctrine. Look at the screen. Next statement. Here it is. Now, here's where I'm going. I'm almost done. God, I'm not going to say that anyway. Intentional sin eventually becomes practice sin. The progression. We're still going on the progression. Notice the process. Here, what's the process? What's it? As you think about it, what's the process? What's it? When a believer first disobeys God, watch what happens now. Come in, what? Our conscience, our spirit, our born again spirit speaks to us. Look at me. We get that uncomfortable feeling. Can I get a witness? Anybody know what I'm talking about? We get that uncomfortable feeling in here. When we disobey God. Amen. And we see Him. Nobody got to tell us. We know it. Because our conscience, our spirit now begins to bear witness with that. And then watch that. Watch. And our spirit begins to cry out, I missed it, man. I missed it. And we should make the necessary correction and make a course change and repent and ask forgiveness. And at that point, if we forsake that sin through genuine repentance, then our heart is cleansed and we're right and we're back in the right fellowship and relationship with God. You know what I mean? Proverbs 28:13, look on the screen. Proverbs 1 said, he who covers his sins will not prosper, but whosoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. And the New Living Translation. People who conceal their sins will not prosper. But if they confess and turn from them, they will receive mercy. And mercy is all about what God doesn't give us. Or what God gives that we don't deserve, we do deserve. That's what mercy is all about. Mercy is all about God not giving us what we do deserve. And we deserve justice. We deserve punishment. Preaching. Amen. Amen. Watch now. What? Don't go to the wound. Stay with me now. Stay with me. Hang on a minute. If we ignore the voice of our conscience, our spirit, watch. This happens. It's happening right now to some of you in this house. If we continue to ignore, you know what happens? There's a veil that begins to cover our heart. And each time we ignore the voice of our conscience, watch, we don't have that uncomfortable feeling like we did.
Amen.
Mm. Voice is smaller, less forceful. The inward uncomfortable feeling is all but gone. And now it becomes harder to hear because our conscience, our spirit, has grown less sensitive. Yet even then, look at me. Yet even then, you can still ask for forgiveness and be restored.
Amen.
If you truly have a change of mind and heart toward the sin that you have committed or that you are presently committing.
Amen.
Each time we ignore the voice of our conscience, look at me. A veil covers our heart until we become past feeling and we become completely insensitive to the Spirit. Watch. And now we can regularly sin without feeling any conviction. And now what? And now we've entered into the state of practicing sin. We went from intentional sin to practicing the sin that we intentionally commit. Am I making any sense?
Amen.
Amen. Somebody say, preacher?
Preacher.
You're crazy. Some of y'all say that anyway. What? And we can still receive forgiveness and even restored. But man, here's the danger. What? Because some of you right here now, which is where some of you are right now. But now, we have little desire to do so. Some of you sitting right here in this house, I'm going to be bad enough to tell you, because I'm old, gray head, don't matter me no more. I'm going downhill, so I'm life anyway. You can shoot me if you want to, I don't care. Some of you really don't have a desire to change. That's a dangerous place to be. That's exactly what I'm talking about. That's how the enemy has deceived you.
Amen.
You went from intensely sinning now to practicing sin, and now really don't feel the uncomfortableness no more. You really don't trouble no more. Wow. Happens. But it happens through a process of time. You keep ignoring. Every time you ignore, there's a veil of hardness. There's a veil that begins to cover your heart. Each time there's a veil. Each time there's a veil. Each time there's a veil. Until you can come and sit just like you're today and never feel uncomfortable. It happens like that. It happens to people that come to church. Wow. God, preacher.
Come on.
Man, where have you been? You better not go back no more. Watch. See, we reach that place. Watch. We reach that place where we no longer see our sin. As sin. And the next step, please watch me. Watch me. It's the process. The next step, because of God's love for you and for us, you know what he'll do? He still has to give up on you. What he'll do? He'll send a prophet, he'll send a pastor, he'll send a friend to try to reach him. And if you don't listen to the message from the pastor, the prophet, or a friend, watch me. God will move to the next step. You know what he uses to reach us? He'll use difficult circumstances. He'll use hardships. Watch me. And he will even use affliction to get your attention. Oh, yeah. Study David's life. Look what he said, David, in Psalm 119, verse 67. David said, before I was afflicted, what did I do? I went astray. But now, I have kept your word. Yeah, now, after he went through hell and high water. David was in. He said, before I was afflicted, I went astray. I left. So the best way for you and I to learn from God, according to his ring, is to stay obedient to what he says. And look at me. And stay away from that three-letter word, sin.
Amen.
Yeah. Can I give you this? Can I give you this?
Yeah.
That much?
Yeah.
I can't leave you right here because I can't get you back out of water.
Yeah.
Watch this. Watch what Paul says to the Corinthian believers. I'm still talking to the church. Watch it. What's God does? Watch what he's doing now. Please don't leave me. Watch what God is doing in his attempt to get you back. To get you back. You that's out there right now, that's not where you need to be with God. You know you're not. Look what he's doing. Look what he's doing trying to get you back. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 31, 32. Look at verse 32. Paul said, but if we would examine, judge ourselves, we would not be judged by God in this world. What? If you judge yourself, God wouldn't have to. Look at me. If we would judge ourselves, God wouldn't have to judge us. Look at the next verse. Yet when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned along with the world. But I ought to say amen right there. Thank God Almighty. He not going to leave me to be condemned with the world. But you know what he's going to do? He's going to discipline me. See, God loves his children very deeply and very dearly. And he will do everything he can to reach you. When sin is involved, God is not really concerned about your present comfort. Hallelujah, preacher. As a matter of fact, he'll do everything he can to keep you very uncomfortable in your sin.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Listen to me. Because he knows the reality of what's best for your life. Above your present comfort. He don't, look at me. God could give a, he don't give a hoot about your present comfort. When it pertains to sin, he could care less about your present comfort. As a matter of fact, he's going to stick pins wherever he can stick pins to gouge you. He'll bring you to service like this, thinking, then all of a sudden all hell breaks loose from the pulpit.
Yeah.
Everything you say, my God, just bing, 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 bing. I woke somebody up. I'm almost done. I'm almost done. Hebrews 12:1, look at it. Look at her. Hebrews 12:1. Look at it. Paul says, New Living Translation. I love this. It says, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. Notice that phrase. That so easily trips us up. What? See, what may be a sin that so easily trips me up may not be a sin that so easily trips you up. It may not be drunkenness, it may not be alcohol or greed or drug addiction or gossip or sex or pornography, any of those obvious sins that easily trips you up. What may trip me up may not trip you up. Listen to me. But we got to know. We got to know the temptation that we are most susceptible to. And then we must do whatever is necessary to cut that bad boy off. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
No, you're not either. And I'm going to read you something here that will get your attention. Mark chapter 9. Let's go, Mike. This will hardly up every devil in hell when you read this. This is what Jesus said about cutting opportunities off the temptation. Look what Jesus said in verse 43 of Mark 9. He says, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. Why? It's better for you to enter life into life maimed rather than having two hands to go to hell into the fire that shall never be quenched, for their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. Ooh, that's and if your foot causes you to sin, cut that bad boy off. It's better for you to enter life lame rather than having 2 feet to be cast into hell into the fire that shall never be quenched, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. He just keeps saying that over. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out, man. Pluck it out. Better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye rather than having 2 eyes to be cast into fire, into hellfire, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. Wow. Out in their sleep, Jesus.
Amen.
But they just woke up. I don't know about you, but I would rather cut what I got to cut off here now, rather than to go to hell where the fire is not quenched and the worm dies not. Amen. I got a fear of hell. I always have. In my life, I got a fear of hell. I ain't going to hell where the fire is never quenched and the worm don't die. I'm going to cut off what I got to cut off. In order to stay right with God, I got to cut it off. You got to cut it off. We got to cut these things off that are separating us from God Almighty. Folks, look at me. Hell is real. You don't want to go to hell. You don't want to go to hell. You don't want no part of that place. Cut it off.
Amen.
Cut it off. I'm pretty sure I don't believe in hell. Well, it don't change the word, man. Word is still in the word. And I promise you, it's still there. It's still there. And it's still burning. And they're still crying. And the rich man's still begging for a drop of water. Tabitha, I'm crazy today. I gotta quit. I done went too far. Should have done all right to open that up. Now I messed everything up. Messed it all up.
Good work, Pastor. Good work.
You don't think God loves you? You don't think the love of the Father is for you even when we commit sin? You don't think He still loves you?
Let me give you these scriptures. I promise I'm wrapping it up. I promise I am. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5 and 6. Let me show you the love of God. Look at it. Look at verse 5, Hebrews 12. And have you forgotten the encouraging words God spoke to you as your children? He said, my child, don't make light of the Lord's discipline. And don't give up when he corrects you. 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 Don't give up when he corrects you. For the Lord disciplines those he loves and punishes each one he accepts as his child. Look at this. As the Father, the Lord disciplines us when we engage in sin. As an earthly father, when my children were small, grown up, when they were rebellious, did wrong, guess what? They were disciplined. Why? Because I didn't love them? No, because I did love them. Amen. You show me a parent that will not discipline their children when they do wrong, and I will show you a parent who's raising a child who will not respect authority and will grow up and be selfish and not know anything but what they want themselves. They're raising little monsters. And we as God's children, when we engage in sin, look at me, he will discipline us. Notice the phrase in verse 5 again, don't give up when God disciplines you, which means it must be difficult, which means it must be painful when God takes you behind the woodshed.
Amen.
All right, verse 10 and 11, Hebrews 12, here it is. God's discipline is always good for us so that we might share in his holiness. Look at it. No discipline is enjoyable while it is happening. It's painful. But afterward, there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way.
Amen.
Look at me. Discipline is painful, man. How many of you have got disciplined by your earthly parent? Let me tell you something. Your heavenly Father is not afraid to use the rod of correction on his children.
Amen.
Look at me. He will take you out behind the woodshed.
Yeah.
Anybody ever been took out behind the woodshed by God? Anybody ever been took out behind the woodshed by the Holy Spirit?
Yeah.
No? Well, good. I pray that he will. I guarantee you'll never forget it. I would rather have 15 earthly father whippings than one whipping from God.
Amen.
And as children of God, listen, I don't use this word, but I'm going to use it. It's kind of stupid for us to choose to follow our desires when they're contrary to God's desires. It's kind of stupid for us to do that. Because you're going to get disciplined. So we can enjoy a lot less pain now by staying clear of sin. Rather than enjoying the pleasures of sin for a season. Believe me. Look at this. I'm going to show you this scripture because the Hebrew, I talk about Moses, Hebrews 10, 11, 25. It's scripture right here. It is on the screen. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. Look at me. Look at me. Man, I had fun in sin. Oh, y'all didn't? You're lying. I had fun in sin. Anybody have fun in sin? Well, there's a couple of you truthful. Some of you ashamed. There is pleasure in sin for a season. There is a season. But the season will run out. But the question is, what kind of destruction will it leave behind? How many lives will it affect? A lot. Innocent lives be affected. Two ways around this. I'm closed, I promise. Two ways around this. One, we can enjoy fullness of life by staying obedient to the Word of God. Or we can choose to veer off toward intentional sin, which leads to practice sin that will produce a life of pain and suffering down the road. You make the choice. To me, it's a no-brainer, but you never know. Okay? Look on the screen. By nature, sin is deceptive. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You know why it's deceptive? Because it's deceptive on how fulfilled that sin will make you. Talk to me, somebody that's been there and done that. Can I get a witness in the house? Don't be ashamed. 90% of you know what that means right there. Well, I mean, no, 95% of us know what that means right there. Because right there is how sin is deceptive. Because sin tries to tell you how fulfilling it will be for you. Oh, 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 Jesus. I felt that plumb down to my toes. Woo, woo. He says, oh, yeah. This is what you need. Oh, yeah, she's what you need. He's what you need. Yeah. Next statement, Michael. You can take this one to the bank. To pay to the harvest will far exceed the pleasures of the planting.
Amen.
Will. It'll leave you devastated. It'll leave you devastated. And something dying in your life.
Mm-hmm.
One more and I'm out. Here it is. Sin deceives. How? It deceives how in control of sin we really are. What? Rather than understanding how controlled by that sin we will be if we continue in it.
Mm-hmm.
Look at me. Look at me. Because when it starts, you think you have control of it. Because sin will not tell you that if you continue in it, it will control you.
Amen.
Before you realize it has already got you.
Amen.
Am I making any sin?
Amen.
How come you can't be like other preachers and let us out here at 12 o'clock? Because I'm not like other preachers.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
Thing about this is, sin deceives. You know what it does? It's worse than that. It distracts us from the true glory that we are called
Amen.
To be.
Amen.
It does. It distracts us from the true glory that we are living. It also hinders you and I from experiencing a spirit-filled relationship with the Messiah, with Jesus Christ. And in the end, we fail to be a revealer of God's glory and God's greatness in our life.
Amen.
That's a good sign. It's closing the book up, that's a good sign. Here's the remedy. Everything that I've told you. Here's the remedy. 1 John 1:9. That if we confess our sins, He, God, is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. And then take another step and cleanse us. All in righteousness. What you think about that, Naomi?
Yes.
Put you right back into fellowship.
Hallelujah.
With God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Some of you can relate to this message today better than others can because you've seen how destructive sin is.
Amen.
Sin can be. Has a terrible power. Today I want to ask you. I'm not going to call you an altar for that day. I've been done it 4 or 5 Sundays in a row. I'm not going to do it. I ain't going to do it. I'm just going to tell you this. If you're in this building today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Maybe you've never been saved. If you're in this building today and you're backslidden in heart, and you're not where you need to be in God, and there's sin in your life, you need to repent today. If you don't feel that uncomfortable in you right down here in the mall, you better run this altar. You better. Let me tell you a story, and I'm quick. I'll tell you, you probably have heard this, these other things have heard it. I can remember as a boy, teenage boy, growing up in the Nazareth Church. One picture of revival. I saw a man from the church had prayed for years to get saved. And the man had a drinking problem. They prayed for him for years and years and years. Revival. Seen him walk off, step out, walk all the way, come right down to the altar, and kneel down and wept. Prayed forever, forever, forever. Seemed like he'd never get done. And here's what he's praying. He wasn't praying to get saved. He was praying for God to speak to him one more time.
Amen.
Just one more time. You don't forget things like that. Because there's a line you'll cross where sin will take you. And you can't get back. It's not that you don't want to. The enemy has deceived you so long that you think you can't get back. Don't tell me you can't cross it. You can, babe. Please, in the name of all common sense, listen to this preacher today. Please hear me. Don't go that far. Don't give your young years to a cruel one. Don't do that. While you're young, give your life to God.
Amen.
Give your life to God. Why are you young? Got so much to offer the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Stand with me, would you please? Stand with me, please. Everybody, the song we pray, come over here. Give me a song. Pass me on. Give me something like that. Just give me something like that. You give me 5 minutes, and I promise you I'll have you out of this house. I'm